Hey folks, this is Dr. Emily Schurting with American Resiliency here with a cross-model overview for the Southern Great Plains. This region, as defined by the Fifth National Climate Assessment, includes Texas, Kansas, and Oklahoma. We've got these regional overview videos done for much of the country. We just got the Northeast and the Northern Great Plains remaining to be covered. I wanted to get this one out there because I've been having a lot of folks asking about Texas. And please note, I will also be doing a regional cross-model overview for the non-continental US, including the many islands in the US territories. So, as we get rolling here on the outlook for the Southern Great Plains, I'm going to be sharing 2C overview projections for the region, and I'm going to be sharing some modeling to give us an idea of what to expect if we have hit a tipping point. Because if you follow climate news, you probably know we're not where we're supposed to be on climate. I recommend checking out the Copernicus Institute's climate bulletins if you like to stay up to date on climate news. You can see right here, they're an official EU operation. They're the EU's climate monitoring service, and their climate bulletins provide a great monthly update released sort of around day 10 of each month for the previous month's information, with some important basic information about how far we are over pre-industrial baseline. Like you saw there, we're still well over 1.5 C, so 2 C is not as far away as anyone would like. Another important source of information for you, the 2 C projections that I'm using, they come from the Fifth National Climate Assessment, which you can find here. And using the publicly available data sets, the American Resiliency team has created a number of visualization resources you can find here on our website, americanresiliency.org, in the resources tab. I'll be using the Jackie Pie visualization tool today. This tool was made by a NASA engineer, Jackie Ryan, and this tool is powered by those publicly available NCI-5 data sets, just like Dustin's visualization above it. Both of these visualizations will continue to give us access to this important information, even if we lose access to .gov sites. So I imagine if you're at all interested in climate in the Southern Great Plains, your question is not, are we going to have problems? Your question is more, how bad are these problems going to be? So let's get in there and work the edges. I think the first and most important information I can give you is high-end heat increase information. How many additional days over 105 are we expecting at 2C? All right, so here we are in the Jackie Pie visualizations, and I want you to think of this color key I'm using is that like we're working metal, where white is hot. And you can see in the big picture view here that there are parts of Texas looking as white hot as Arizona in this visualization. You can see there's a band of pretty extreme heat projected to kind of shoot up the middle of the country with pretty serious impacts through Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas. And I know you all are tough, you don't mind a little heat, but a prolonged stretch over 105 is hard on the body, and that is what these projections are showing. Let's zoom in and see more about what cities are impacted. You can see your cities and your county lines start becoming clear as you zoom in on Jackie Pie's visualizations. We can see up in Kansas, where we're kind of hitting the edge of that most extreme heat. In Wichita, we're expecting an additional 9 days over 105 by 2C. The whole Dallas-Fort Worth area, you're looking at 10 to 12 days over 105 additional at 2C. Scroll down here, you can see that Laredo is just blistering, additional 22 days over 2C. And looking at Houston, we just see one additional day over 105 projected, but that is unpleasant. And I want to show you something cool about this visualization here. We can go over and look at number of projected days over 100 really easily, and we can see there Houston is picking up quite a few. We're looking at an additional almost 12 days over 100 plus that one day over 105. And remember, it's humid, so let's check out days over 95 too, where Houston's projecting 34 additional days in that heat band. And to get your total hot season increase, you need to visualize all three of those levels and add them together. So for Houston, that's an additional 47 days over 95 projected by 2C. That's very challenging in a humid climate. I took a minute to step away from the visualization because I want to share some info about AC, which I'm sure you're thinking about. This is from Jason L., AR community member who wrote me to share some important perspective from his business partner, who's an HVAC contractor. Jason L. writes, "My business partner is an HVAC contractor. I'm a contractor in a different trade. Last August, I noticed we were getting a lot of calls for my AC isn't keeping up, meaning the house was no longer cooling, was creeping towards 80, towards 85 inside. Anyway, I asked my partner what's going on. Some of these were newer units that we'd installed recently. He told me the AC won't keep up when the nighttime temps stay above 85 for long periods. Our houses are relatively sealed. They can handle a few days' worth of this. When it's a week or longer, your home's going to start to creep up a degree or two each day. The AC isn't designed for that. This was a rare problem before, but where we're headed, it might be a solid problem in July, August, and September in places where we think maybe that we have AC resiliency built up. For more clarity, Jason L. writes that the AC in the region he's talking about, Central Florida, is designed for an average temperature of 85F. That helps the units work efficiently through the year. Historically, if you design the systems to a higher average temperature, then they're going to cool too fast the rest of the time and not reduce humidity. His business partner tells him that if you try to design a home to a 90 degree F average, the building department is going to want justification and will often turn down the permit. Jason L., thanks for these insights. If I were in Texas wanting to stay in Texas, I'd consider those limits of AC pretty carefully, especially if I was thinking about putting in a new unit. Nighttime heat increases are also projecting pretty significant across this region. So that round-the-clock heat problem Jason L. describes will be relevant in many of Texas's cities. Okay, let's get back to the data. We're seeing in that visualization that much of the Southern Great Plains is looking really hot, bigger heat increases than average as we move towards 2C, long overall hot season extensions, longer peaks over 105 than they're used to feeling on the ground across the region here. Of the region, Northeast Kansas is looking best, most in adaptation range. Another spot of interest is Corpus Christi down in Texas. So the Texas Gulf is likely to be very seriously impacted by sea level rise, serious risk that home insurance companies are watching and responded to. But I wanted to note, Corpus Christi is looking relatively okay on the heat up and on sea level rise. We're starting to get some flakiness showing up in the .gov tools, I'm sad to say. I wanted to show you this non.gov tool that I highly recommend. It's coastal.climatecentral.org. It's very stable and it's a worldwide tool. So zooming in here on Corpus Christi, we can see that at a foot of sea level rise nearby Port Aransas is already severely impacted. If we go up more towards over 3 feet, we see that we're starting to really lose the keys to coastal inundation. But a lot of Corpus Christi is built up on a rise here. And like I said, not looking as bad in those heat projections. Even if we look really far out towards higher levels of sea level rise than we're likely to see at all in like the next 20, 30 years, we can see relatively little damage to the built environment or towards a lot of the infrastructure in Corpus Christi. Even when we see, unfortunately, complete inundation of those lower lying and barrier island areas. And all around the Gulf, we expect the Texas Gulf properties to experience very severe losses and damage. I think that a lot of folks in this region, they think kind of like me, where they want to look at the bright spots, they want to look at the edges of the problem. So I'm always happy when I can find something that gives you a little bright spot to build around, like maybe we're seeing there in Corpus Christi. It's good for us to look at the edges of this problem in Texas, because Texas has a real Texas-sized problem in these projections. We looked at the heat, right? We know a landscape needs more water as it gets hotter. So now we're going to look at a couple of figures from the Fifth National Climate Assessment, a couple of models for precipitation changes we approach 2C to see if we got any hope in this region of getting that water. So here's figure 210 from the NCA5, where we can see that there is statistically significant increase in water projected here in this area that was least impacted by heat up in northeast Kansas, extending through eastern Oklahoma and into Texas. And you see this blue overlaying a lot of Texas in this figure. But we got to check out another model. Here's figure 4.3 from the NCA5, where we do see confirmation, particularly in northeast Kansas, another sign that there may be more water coming, enough water to offset the heat in northeast Kansas and even into the very eastern edge of Oklahoma. But here we don't see the same trend for even to maybe a little bit more precipitation across Texas. We see a drought trend. Let's get these side by side, 210 and 4.3. So just to give us some more clarity in the side by side, the two models that we're looking at, they projected percentage change and they projected change in inches. In the percentage change one, The cross-hatching is where we expect statistical significance. So we can see that there's some real uncertainty between the models over Texas, and where we're looking at these dark spots. We're looking at a significant measurable drought trend. We're looking at a loss of as much as a couple of inches of precipitation a year. But on the bright spot side, we can see confirmation across models that in the Topeka area heading into Kansas City, it looks like there's an edge to hold. It looks like we're going to get the precipitation we're going to need to stay in adaptation range with that increased heat. Folks, if you love this region, if you're committed to this region, I just want you to know what you're up against. I just want to get you information that hopefully you can use to prepare and respond to change. You can see the change coming just in those two type of figures, hot season increases that are among the biggest in the country. You saw that hot spot in Southern California through Arizona in the big picture look. You too, Southern California and Arizona and parts of Texas. Those two areas look the worst in the nation on the high-end heat increase factor. You put together the big hot season extension and the notable drought trend, that's going to be rough on the landscape. It's going to test the limits of our infrastructure, as we heard from those contractors. In Texas, your ability to respond is going to be complicated by the degree to which sea level rise is projected to impact the state. It's going to be billions of dollars in real estate losses. It's going to destabilize, I think, the insurance market. I mean, like the home insurance market is facing destabilizing risks in so many regions, right? We're talking about a national problem. But focusing in on the region, sea level rise is going to impact Houston, including the big medical complex there, which is such an important place for children's health in this region. It's a critical place of hope for so many families throughout the region, families whose children have serious and complex diagnoses. It's really highlights seeing the risk to that complex, the cascading risks and impacts these changes might have towards quality of life and services throughout the region. If you're in this region, I want you to have a plan. I want you thinking hard about heat resilience and water resilience. What are you going to do if the power goes out during one of these long projected hot spells? Let's look at the tipping point side of things now. Because alongside the heat, I'm sure you all remember that this winter we had that big winter storm dropping snow all along the Gulf. 12 inches in New Orleans, big snow in Florida. We know the Southern Great Plains gets hit by occasional serious cold snaps. We know that's happened with tragic, serious impacts to the grid. We know that's happened with tragic, serious impacts to the grid in Texas. We know people, kids have died of cold in Texas in recent years. That's how important energy resilience is for your household in this region. Those are the stakes. Oklahoma and Kansas, I'm not mentioning you so much because your grid issues, while serious, are not as serious as Texas, and you all plan for more cold. You all expect more cold. And that's really the frustrating thing in this region, is that even with those big hot spells, you're still going to get that extreme cold coming in. Your baseline winter lows aren't projected to lift that much. So building resilience against cold across the region is going to be important as we move into this challenging future. You're going to want to plan to stay warm in case the power goes out, which can be as simple as some good wool blankets and a plan to have everyone in the house camp out in the best insulated room, or more complicated, like a backup power system. I feel it's important to say, never run a generator inside your house, it's going to put exhaust into your neighbor's house. An improperly used generator is really dangerous. Whatever your plan is, having one matters, and testing it under non-emergency conditions can help you respond calmly in a disaster. And disaster preparedness matters. We need to be able to look after ourselves and our communities. Especially if we are reaching a tipping point, if we are seeing changes to the Gulf Stream that's going to make this sort of polar vortex activity, where Arctic air splooshes down over America as far south as freaking Florida, just like it did this winter. That's going to make that become more common if the Gulf Stream is changing. We are looking at a particularly nasty, why not both, situation in the future for this region. Here's some modeling for how we'd expect things to change in your region if the Gulf Stream does get real weird, if we do see AMOC collapse. You can see in the precipitation trend here, we still expect a drought trend. And we can see that in terms of surface temperatures, we expect a mild cooling trend. We're expecting a cooling trend that would push against that heating trend, not a cooling trend that's going to be like apocalyptic, like we see over here over northern Europe. You can see on that dark key, we're talking about like a negative 20 plus change in degrees C, which are big degrees. So those two factors on balance, I don't know, it's like the same kind of bad that we're seeing in the conventional warming projections, but I'm worried about the winds. Let's look down here. So this scale is in velocity potential, and we can see that by the Texas Gulf, we're looking at a real increase in velocity potential for the winds in this tipping point scenario. And that's concerning. You all already have problems with high winds there. And as we're talking high winds, I'm sure you are also thinking hurricanes. So here we're out of tipping point projections. We're going back to conventional modeling projections. This is actually from the NCA4, not the NCA5 like we've been looking at previously. We can see this end of century modeling is actually being more accurate than we might like for summers of 23 and 24, where we're seeing hurricanes start to go over Big Bend in Florida, high consensus on this inland hurricane track. But if you're in the Texas Gulf, it looks like maybe less hurricanes are going to make landfall in the Texas Gulf area in these projections, which is nice to know. You can see the ones that are heading at you are going to be big and bad. We're talking about a lot of Cat 4s heading your way, but it looks like maybe not so much landfall. So you got to be ready. You want to be resilient against major hurricanes, but there might be a tiny bright spot here. There might be a little edge to hold. So as we look at this region, Kansas through Texas, your best spot for building resilience is going to be Northeast Kansas. That's the spot with the strongest projections in the region. And there's still challenging projections. You're still looking at meaningful heat increases, but with more water coming, you've got a better chance of landscape stability. When we look to the future, that line of high-end heat increase projected for the region, that change implies a need for changes to the built environment. We're going to need more than AC, as in that quote that I shared from HVAC Guy. We're going to need to think differently about AC and about building design to tolerate this level of prolonged extreme heat. And of course, the heat and the drought are going to have big implications for agriculture throughout the region. This is heat that will impact the health of livestock. The Ogallala is already tapped out in many places. The groundwater has been horribly abused in this region. I think it's interesting how much of that high-end heat increase overlays the most abused part of the groundwater systems. It's not scientific to say so, but it feels like a cry of rage coming out of the ground. This is a region where I've spent some real time on the ground, particularly in Kansas, in Wichita, Kansas. If you're digging in any of these three states, I encourage you to check out your state level outlook on this channel to get more information on more factors in the projections and more suggestions for building resilience on the ground. And I have to say, in my time on the ground in your region, I've been so well treated. I've met so many good people throughout this region. The best time my car ever broke down was as a young woman in Amarillo, Texas. I'll never forget the kindness and just the positive approach to adversity I encountered all around in Amarillo. You take it on the nose and you get it done and you go have some fun after. I like that spirit. I know y'all are tough, and I hope this information helps you see the edges to the problem you need to work. It's a big problem that demands a response to help keep yourself and your family safe. If relocation is on the table, there are places with much more moderate outlooks than we find in this region and where we could use your skills and your indomitable spirit. I have to say, I think that many parts of the U.S. would be tremendously enriched by some more energy from the Southern Great Plains. I hope I've helped you here on your learning journey, and I'm wishing you all the best. Let's get ready. Folks, thanks for spending some time learning with me, and I want to thank you all quite sincerely. You know, AR is where it is because of the AR community, the donors, the volunteers, people spreading the word online, and most importantly, all of us doing the work on the ground to grow and strengthen habitats, food systems, and communities. We're getting ready for our volunteer ground launch, and the response has been amazing. I look forward to bringing you stories from dozens of volunteer leaders throughout 2025. If you'd like to make a donation, you will be supporting change in communities on the ground across America through 2025. You can donate at www.americanresiliency.org. Thank you for getting ready with me and talk with you again soon.